It was described as our loss of innocence. But the mosque shootings in Christchurch on March 15, 2019 weren't New Zealand's first terror attacks.
An explosion blew out the front doors of the Whanganui Computer Centre at 25 to 1 this morning. The explosion killed one person, believed to be a young man who's understood to have been carrying a bomb.
On November 18, 1982, anarchist Neil Roberts attempted to destroy the New Zealand Police's computer centre in Whanganui, our first digital database containing information on citizens and their convictions, should become a symbol of government surveillance. The 22-year-old punk had spray-painted the phrase, "We've maintained a silence closely resembling stupidity," on a nearby toilet block before then entering the foyer of the police building and igniting 2 kilograms of gel ignite. The explosion failed to destroy the centre and killed only himself.
The chap I was on with said, "What was that?" I said, "Well, it was a bomb." He said, "Did the chap get away?" I said, "No way." Anyway, I got a torch and shone the torch, just like a butcher's shop.
In the years since, many in the punk scene have marked Neil Roberts' Day with an annual pilgrimage to the Whanganui Police Computer Centre to mark the protest against increasing police surveillance. In 1984, an explosion ripped through Trades Hall in Wellington, headquarters of a number of trade unions. The explosion killed the building's caretaker, Ernie Abbott, when he moved the suitcase containing the bomb that had been left in the foyer, setting off its sophisticated mercury trigger. But despite 80 police working on the investigation and a $50,000 reward, to this day the perpetrator has never been identified. Before setting sail to protest French nuclear testing in the Pacific, the Greenpeace flagship, the Rainbow Warrior, was sabotaged in the dead of night in Auckland Harbour. To prevent the ship from sailing, French intelligence agents attached 2 mines against its hull and detonated them just before midnight on the 10th of July 1985, killing crew member Fernando Pereira in the attack.
He went back supposedly for his photographic gear. Somewhere between the first blast and the second blast, he either got knocked over by the blast, drowned, we don't know.
The French government, which was allied to New Zealand at the time, initially denied involvement and condemned what they described as a terrorist act until 2 of their agents were caught. The French government apologised and paid out over $13 million to the New Zealand government, $8.6 million to Greenpeace, and over $500,000 to the Pereira family. 10 years later, they stopped nuclear testing. The convicted spies were sentenced to 10 years in prison, but once handed over to the French authorities, served only 2 years before being released. The shell of the Rainbow Warrior was taken out to sea and now rests at the bottom of Matauri Bay. Though these cases of terrorism from our past span the political spectrum, from a radical anarchist lashing out at police to attacks that struck at the heart of the Labour and Green movements, none of them have been from radical Islamists or from Māori activists, which have been a focus of our security services in recent times. In 2002, the New Zealand government introduced the Terrorism Suppression Act and carried out raids across the country in 2007 of what it saw as domestic terrorist targets. Yet they failed to find enough evidence, and as a result, the charges were dropped and police apologised. The law has since been amended.
They should have been treated with absolute respect, and I've apologised because that did not occur.
With the alleged Christchurch shooter before the courts on charges of terrorism, he may be the first person ever convicted under the Act. With a Royal Commission reviewing the attack, our counter-terrorist efforts may be aimed in a different direction in the future.